Rashid Salimi.
I don't know anyone named Rashid.
You're willing to take a polygraph?
Of course.
As he comes around and for the line, are you familiar with him? I want to get in there.
If I have a passion as a filmmaker, it is always to try and take a thematic idea that can be approached intellectually and do that, but also approach it emotionally and humanize it. One of the challenges in telling a multi-layered story, just from a directing point of view, is how to keep every story in balance.
What do we got?
Douglas Freeman, analyst.
An analyst is not a jackal.
You need to get to the core of that story and understand those people as quickly and yet as fully as possible. Essentially, what you're doing is you're making, say, 4 or 5 short films and weaving them together.
Not getting anything.
We have 2 days to sort of really establish the look of Washington. And as you can see behind me, there's a deep fog here, and we've set up a shot that's going to look across the tidal basin and see the Jefferson Memorial in the background.
It's actually getting worse out there.
I know.
Because now those little lights are...
So we're going to wait for a second.
It's like torture.
Hopefully the fog will eventually clear, but if it doesn't, we'll have spent 2 days in Washington filming here and we'll have seen nothing of the Washington monuments.
We move them into the bigger opening.
This opening here is better.
Which means they, you know, they end up a little on the same side as the monument, which is...
Because your track ends where?
Yeah. Well, no, because you haven't got separation between the monument and the...
There it is!
Now you can really see it.
Yay!
You're looking at the iconic images of Washington, the Capitol building and so on. And I remember Dion and I were going, it just feels a bit conventional, it feels a bit conventional. And I remember Dion saying to me, we gotta hide these monuments. And we started driving around and looking at monuments from positions where you couldn't quite see them.
So, it's just a good one. It's outside lane. Just why is it like that Rochester now?
You frame up.
And we went up into one building, and we saw the Capitol building through a modern building's glass facade. Vertical kind of columns and glass plates.
Rolling. Action.
And it just had this sense of the old Washington, with its values that have stood for so long, being pushed back. And a new Washington trying to impose itself upon the old.
What was great with Gavin and I, we sort of discovered a language for the movie. We didn't want to pursue a handheld, gritty, doco style. We wanted a formal style, strongly composed, with a certain beauty to it.
I think it's interesting. I sort of deflected as I dropped the city and made it.
So you're a little figure in a rather beige and bland hotel under the big city outside.
I mean, so you want a difference between when I'm talking to Jeremy and when I'm talking to Nero?
Well, I mean, maybe in the beginning it's something like carries there, and then when this conversation gets more, that we kind of lose that, and I might be able to punch you on the front father.
To me, the interesting element of this was that each person's story is about isolation. It isn't about connection. It isn't about us ultimately all being the same. It's about how singular we all are in the world.
I'm sure it's all just some sort of mistake.
I had a lot of curiosity and interest in what it must be like to be living as part of a Muslim family in America.
Jeremy, that was such a good thing.
Come on, Mom, get the ball.
There's a lot of fear that has been propagated. Ever since 9/11, it's been difficult for those families to travel. It's difficult to be in a community and establish themselves as regular people.
Is he at all, he was talking about Japanese art.
There's such a large amount of fear in this country that if you are perceived as at all being aligned with the wrong side, you're doomed, you're gone.
We got a bill we're trying to get passed. This business is just gonna muddy things up. You wanna be the guy who never has to compromise? Go join Amnesty International.
I think part of what my character learns in this movie is that if you fight that too hard, you become irrelevant.
So you've tried to fight, and then he hits you with a sucker punch, and he says, drop it.
Okay, I got it.
If we want to get into a fight about rendition, it's got to be the right fight at the right time. It's got to be a watertight case, and this ain't it.
That's the realities of Washington, and that's the realities of this country.
Douglas Freeman.
Who is this?
Corinne Whitman. Lee Mayer speaks very highly of you.
I'm the kind of person who sits at home and screams at the television news. It's very, very interesting to climb into the shoes of people whose purview it is to safeguard the nation and really think about how far you'd go to do that.
All right, well, what do you want to do? Can't keep him here indefinitely.
I'm on a plane.
I feel great compassion for the people that choose to stand up and be public servants in the world we live in now, because it's hard.
Meryl Streep, Peter Sarsgaard, Alan Arkin playing these Washington-based roles, all of them are iconic in their own right. They carry, as actors, a sense of authority and power, and this Washington storyline is about having that power in your hand and what you do with it.
I'm giving you the authorization.
I didn't want to shoot in the States because Rendition is set in a fictional North African country. I didn't want to build a stage and try and pretend that we were somewhere else, because there's such an energy that the actors and the director and the DP and everyone get from being in another world. And Morocco is an amazing country. All of us who went there came back profoundly affected.
2 years ago, I shot Babel here, and when I read the script, I knew immediately that we'd wind up going to Morocco, because it's a very film-friendly environment, and it has a very Middle Eastern look.
The other street is a nice, wide street with only like 20 doorways to get to Arkin. So this is where Khalid comes when he comes the first time.
When we scouted in Marrakesh in particular as a town, just in terms of its color palette and its energy and the ancient city and these wonderful alleys that exist, you go, why would I want to build this? I mean, just point your camera and you get a great shot. It's just cinematically a dream. It's both a quality of light and a texture in the landscape, the way the landscape kicks back, the reds of the earth. And so everything has a sort of heightened reality to it.
Next is in. I'm practicing my Arabic. As we go this way, which gives us a little more room on this fountain, and then we go this way.
We didn't come here for the big vistas. We came here more for the Medina and the streets and the back alleys.
One small donkey cart trying to make its way through. So Nordine, you're on the back of the bike with me. Okay, go. Just going in this direction, on steady cam, ducking here, which is just to sell Khalid's neighborhood.
You know, both he and I run around with stills cameras all the time. I have my stills camera with me when I scout, and Dion has his. Because it's difficult to talk visually in the abstract. It helps when you actually see it. Say, this is what I'm seeing. I'm looking at it like this. How are you looking at it?
So we're here, bro. It does help just to snake that road a bit.
And we'd go back and download our pictures and look at the pictures and gradually build up the film from those images so that we were constantly in visual sync.
You're trying to create any street activity out, that'd be very difficult because of how busy it is.
You mean this?
The roundabout beyond the street. I think that can just go live.
Try and go live, you'll have 1,000 people watching. You can never do that here. Just as a stress that, you can never do the real life
thing. Same thing I told you in
there. With the
same
crew size we're going to have.
L'histoire du film, ça se passe dans un pays du Moyen-Orient, ou un pays arabe, et on veut garder le même aspect de la vie normale de tous les jours. Donc il y a les enfants, il y a les vieux, il y a les femmes, il y a toutes sortes. Donc on veut garder ce rythme avec les gens qui sont sur bicyclette, moto, les gens qui marchent, qui font le marché, donc on va garder la vie normale. Pour ce film, on aura besoin au total de 4500 figurants. On essaye de faire un mélange de tous les âges, de tous les sexes différents. Normalement, oui, pour la plupart des figurants qu'on utilise, ils ont déjà participé avec nous dans plusieurs films. Ils sont devenus des gens un peu professionnels. Mais en même temps, on rajoute des gens nouveaux parce qu'on cherche toujours, Ça dépend des besoins du film.
We're standing in a little district called Bukaz, which is near the airport in Marrakesh. It's a very quiet little area that's only built in the last 20 years. And this is where we're building our square location for the movie, which is about 8 days filming. Shut down the whole square, change every house, do an explosion, raise our own roundabout, traffic, and everything else.
Shukran, Bizef. Thank you, shukran.
It's a very friendly group of people here. They're all very happy with us. Change their houses, paint them, decorate them, turn them into cafes, shops, restaurants, and everything.
Was very kindly brought to us from the man across the street. He says we may or may not be using this house as a location.
He's buttering us up.
But it's good.
This big sequence in the square and the blast was really the one sequence that we storyboarded and was discussed in a lot of detail. And the fact that we had so many different elements that had to be choreographed and coordinated around this event.
In terms of saving budget, I personally don't need to place 500
people, no, but you do need to place your key vehicles.
The traffic, key vehicles.
And you need to know the exact
then,
number of people that
you
need.
And then I thought, Gavin, at the end of one of the Khalid house days,
we
could go with stand-ins,
yeah.
And go with lenses, and we can lens up the directions and the specials.
And I would like a map of that square with little cars. Sounds silly, but
we'll
stand around a table together and you guys will all know exactly where everything's placed.
First time Khalid and Fatima come down this alley on the moped, they come in here, and the first thing to remember is that none of these cars are orientated like this because it's actually 4 days earlier in the movie. You guys need to think very carefully about how to make the square look different but not different, which is really odd challenge.
Really looking at this, that first time, traffic's moving. Second time, traffic's really coming to a stop.
So yes, because that's when the donkey car stops. That is the big difference. We're looking through the fountain, then there's fountain dancing in front of us, and she's going, Khalid, but he's deep enough back, he's not hearing it. She can't run straight to him because she's blocked by a fountain.
Yeah.
So it just extends the tension between the time that they see each other and the time they meet.
I imagine a 5-foot wall of jets. It's pretty dominant.
No, I know exactly what your concern is, because we're going to be in a 2-3-5 frame panning across here, and the whole middle of the frame you're afraid is one long white wall of water. But it won't. It really won't.
Is it possible to get above straight, please?
Okay, Biebs, do the tracking shot. Now we're going to be twice as thick, but if you feel it's too much, we'll just shut off certain rows. That's okay, and we'll just take rows out.
It's a complicated sequence of events because so much happens in literally over a 3 or 4 minute period of time.
I just want to get to that hand, and I can bring her even lower, Dion, but I want to be able to come down from her to this place.
And we knew we were going to have to shoot it over at least the course of a week.
Romo's coming from the other side here, and we're taking him inside to this place right in here. Now, we are seeing the scene from the point of view of this man right here. Here's the gunman, right here. Right, here he is. To make this as efficient as possible, what I want to do is I want to get everything shot completely up until the moment of that explosion.
Three, two, one.
I'm just thinking about what little screen time we have to sort of sell this thing. I mean,
yeah, that we can't wait.
The maximum impact is going to be that coming at us.
Sorry, that's Khalid.
Yeah. Flash around there towards camera. So yeah, that you pick that up. We'll have pops blowing back here.
Given that we're doing sort of as a subjective point of view of Douglas.
Yeah.
The minute that thing's coming at him, he's going, which means we're not lingering out the way you would if you're making sort of action movies.
Andy's making this explosion throw in this direction because we only shoot it from this angle. There are no cameras looking from the tops of buildings. There's not 12 cameras on an explosion going up. It's not an action movie. Oh, is it going to work?
Of course it's going to work.
Yeah, kill the town. Kill the town.
Good.
I'll try to bless it.
It's always difficult to shoot in any cities in the whole world, especially in Morocco, you know, because you have traffic problems, you have access problem. If you want to film inside the Medina, the streets of Medina of Marrakech, instead of bringing the trucks inside the streets, you hired the small crates and you put your equipment there.
Marrakech, everyone is there. The locals, the tourists, you can't stop the traffic the whole day. You have to release between takes.
Three marker.
Action, Jake.
Say, you're not a case officer, Douglas.
No.
I think we've seen a lot of movies about how people's lives are all interconnected.
Action.
I think that's a dramatic conceit that has been used and is popular now.
So Dixon was replacing Sims.
Yeah.
Yes, and now it's you.
Now it's me.
So for me, it's like how they're interconnected is less of a question than where all these people start and where they finish and their journeys.
All of a sudden, Omar, the actor Omar Metwally, became available. He's on another picture in Argentina right now, but he's available, so he came in so that he could start to grow his beard as soon as he wraps his other picture, and we wouldn't have to do this scene, which is where he's cleanly shaven. So he came in for us, shoot this one day, he's gonna go back to Argentina, wrap his picture and start growing a beard.
Yeah, he can't lift his hands up high because of... There we go. It's
not seeing the shackles.
Exactly. And I'm trying to think. Give us a little more slack. Sure. Why am I shackled?
Are you familiar with bomb-making techniques?
What?
Have you ever constructed a bomb?
This is ridiculous. Cut print. That was even better. I'm good.
You are?
You're good? You want to do one more for life?
Make the first half.
Let's do the whole thing. One last time. The point is, you know what I said to you. When I have it, I have it. And then I want to be able to play for you because now the pressure's off to what you want.
Okay.
What comes up again and again is torture is an isolating experience. Pain draws one into oneself. One of the things I liked about the script and one of the things that's really important is to show a man who's going through this alone.
Him coming here, him sitting on the bike, yeah, just seeing the bike through the arch.
Background action! And Zineb!
I felt that this particular aspect of the story was really the heart of the story, Fatima and Khalid as the Romeo and Juliet, two young people whose lives are being really affected by forces beyond their control. I felt that it was important for them to be able to speak in their native language. That it would give a richness and texture to the film.
there, Zeynep, so that she stops because of your voice. That's why I don't waste, we won't waste time.
He has a lot of energy and he gives you everything. And when somebody gives you everything, you want to give him everything.
Do the same turn, her coming in, doing the photograph, all of you, but just much closer.
I like directors who had been already, you know, their life actors also, because they know the process to create an emotion or to give something.
Gavin is from South Africa. He's grown up in a political environment more so than a lot of Americans. And I think he was very sensitive to the material. He has friends that were taken away, that, you know, there wasn't a trace of them. So I think it was something that he had a great affinity towards.
When I finished reading the script, I just remember sitting for days going, what do I think about this? It was raising profound and difficult questions. What are the right techniques to obtain information that might stop another 9/11? Because once you throw the rule book out and say, hey, there are no rules, it's a dirty war, well, then it's a dirty war.
Fourth group. They can have breakfast early and at the door checkpoint and questions.
You know, we used to work with the big numbers. We have the pictures of each one, then we start to make badges. It just beep, and everything you have it in this program. You have the pay list, you have, you know, fittings, shooting, building, transport, catering, everything.
We put together a great team of ADs from Morocco who understood how to work the Moroccan system. They help set up the extras and communicate with the extras. Like today, we have 500 extras. It would take us hours and take us much longer to do in the United States.
We got 70 cars, roughly, 60 mopeds, bicycles, donkey carts, in all about 150 vehicles, I suppose. We find them, and then they come along with their own car, and all the extras have brought their own mopeds along. And we pay them a bit extra for that.
Right here. Vas-y, let's go. Let's go.
Okay, Sachon, Sachon.
Haraka!
Part of the excitement and interest about this story and how it is written and how it unfolds is that we feel these parallel timelines that ultimately turn out to be flashback. Planning it out, all these different events that take place within this tiny little window of time, it was essential that we had a continuity of life.
I want to go before the light loses on that donkey, so we should shoot in 2 minutes because that donkey's going to go. Okay, Chuck, my light's about to go on the donkey, so let me just see that vest on him.
Put your head in there.
Here it comes.
Great, let's go.
Good.
Yeah. Got to get one of these in the can.
We pretty much had to back ourselves into the same time of day every day so that the light would match, the sun position would match. That if this person was in shadow when this event happened, they had to remain in shadow when I saw it from another point of view, or I went inside the car, or came inside the tunnel as we approached the square. So it was just plotting that out and working with Gavin and with, you know, Peter Carr and our first AD to to maximize the time we have.
Good morning.
Donc quand le caméra n'est pas ici, c'est le quoi?
C'est le quoi?
Et quand je monte en position, c'est le X.
We're going English to French to Arabic.
Est-ce que tu le vois? Non. Tarek!
No. Thank you, sir. Here we go.
Once it's open, once they open it, will allow you the time to build up in the bush. Okay? And sometime I'm going to hit you. Okay, okay. And if you feel you want to close it again, you close it and do it again. Okay, okay? All right, so let's tear you up.
بابا أرجوك خالد.
The story is told from multiple angles because it humanizes the problem.
It already opens by the
thing that's obviously all of them exist in service of a kind of meta story, the story of the film itself, which centers around this one suicide bombing and the way it pulls different lives together in search of, if you like, some sort of overarching truth.
There'll be a 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and then they will have the explosion. So after the explosion, we're gonna keep cameras rolling until we say cut, and then no one should move. Everybody should stay where they are until we get the all safe from the effects guys and our stuntman.
Well, this is a day we've been preparing for about 6 months, from the time we first designed the square. We finished shooting all the sequences in it, and today is the day of the explosion when we blow it up. So here we go, three cameras running on a big explosion.
Let's charge those air mortars now, please, Andrew. Let's go hot now.
We're hot.
Go, camera. Is that it?
Shukran bizzaf, thank you very much. It was absolutely outstanding. We do not need to do it again. Well done. It was good. It was a good day. What I love about films and story is that essentially they are ways of discussing problems.
Roll cameras!
How do we go about extracting information from people who we think might be guilty? What we wanted to do in the film is try and present every argument around this very complex issue from as many sides as possible. And not in a purely intellectual way, but in a very visceral and emotional way. I hope that the film on another level is just a poetic lament about where we as human beings are in our conflict with one another.